This week on One Devotion, a Euroleague rookie opens the book on his unique hobby. A born hustler reveals the sources of his trademark intensity. Two superstars tell us about the last back-to-back champions. And a veteran warrior turns in the week's best individual performance. When he's not helping Fenerbahçe Istanbul reach new heights with his prowess under the rims, Euroleague rookie Epe Udo has a decidedly unique way of spending his spare time, running a book club. Udo had the idea when he was playing in the NBA and admits that it was not something he would have expected himself to do when he was younger.
Funny part is, as a kid, I didn't read at all. You know, I just read whatever was in school to get by. And then in college, I had this friend of mine, Brandon Greer. He used to email me articles, you know, and I wouldn't read them, but he kept on doing it. And I got into reading probably 3 years ago when I was with the Milwaukee Bucks. And then I started the book club, and it's been going ever since. As a kid, I never wanted to be in a book club, thought it was, you know, for geeks or whatever. But as I got older, man, you have to do it, you know, if you want to continue to grow, you know, mentally, spiritually or whatnot.
Fittingly for a man whose profession takes him all over the world, Udo's book club is a very modern initiative, using technology to bring people together. The club started off on Twitter and now also has its own Facebook page.
I just wanted to do Twitter because I couldn't really do the in-person book club meetup because of the schedule. And Twitter is an amazing tool, you know, to connect people all around the world. It starts off with me sending out a link through MailChimp, and they'll sign up. A good number for us is like 25. You know, I'll get 25 people. I'll send out the books, send out the reading itinerary, and the discussion times. The book, I pick out the books by reviews. You know, I'll ask the clubbers, the book clubbers, you know, what type of book they like to read. Sometimes we go with that, or I'll get a recommendation from an old coach or a friend or a mentor of mine, and we'll try that book out.
The group has also held one in-person meeting, and Udo is hoping for the opportunity to arrange more of those in the future.
We had a meetup 2 years ago in Dallas, Texas. Last year didn't happen, this summer didn't happen, had a lot going on, but you know, hopefully to get another one in is great, you know, especially when it's behind a book that we've read that turns into a movie. So we'll be able to watch the movie together and then go out to eat and then talk about that book movie.
The meetup lets Udo take the shared, long-distance hobby of reading books together one step further.
You put a face behind the tweets, you know, you put a face behind the answers, and you know, it's great, man, because you know, just small stuff like that, you can build, you know, a relationship that lasts forever.
Naturally, word has spread in Udo's locker rooms about his reading activities, and the good response from his teammates has been supportive.
It's cool. I mean, they like it. And, you know, I see people come to me more asking me all type of questions because, you know, they see that I'm reading something. So they're like, oh, he must read everything. So it's a great feeling.
And although Udo is mainly motivated by the thought of helping and connecting with other people, he admits that reading has also greatly enhanced his own life.
It's changed me a lot because reading outside of my subject, which is basketball, and it allows me to talk to any type of person, you know, and connect beyond, oh, you play basketball. Well, let me tell you some other stuff I know about in life.
With a new head coach and two early double-digit defeats to start the 2012-13 season, Olympiakos Piraeus found that defending the Euroleague title was not going to be the least bit easy after having won it the previous spring with the biggest comeback in championship game history. For one thing, the Reds learned quickly that besides jersey numbers, they now had a giant target on their backs as well.
It was really harder because everybody wants to win the first, the champion. Everybody wants to take glory if you win the champion, and that make our job more difficult.
Even after an 8-game winning streak confirmed the solid system that Georgios Bartsokas had put in place, the doubts continued when the Reds stumbled again, losing 3 of their first 4 top 16 games, and when they were behind by 15 points against Anadolu Efes in the 5th and final playoff game. But if defending the title meant not losing any more games, having their backs against the wall suited the Reds just fine.
That was kind of the spirit of the team we had with Olympiakos. I mean, we kind of internally called ourselves kind of like the comeback kids because we were down. We had so many different situations and so many different games where we were down.
After they rallied to beat FS by 10, it was clearer than ever that to Olympiakos, down never meant out. What's more, the returning champs still felt they had a lot of doubters to silence as they headed for the Final Four in London.
We were definitely on a mission, coming in because, you know, we were at the time the defending champions. And I think coming in, we were still considered the underdogs. So a lot of people didn't believe that, you know, that we belonged there or you can play with these teams. So as a team, you know, we kind of had an internal mission that we wanted to show and we wanted to prove to everybody that we belong, not only belong here, but we were the best team there.
In the semi-final at the O2 in London, Olympiakos proved it had the best defense there by winning easily 52-69 and holding favored CSKA Moscow to its lowest points total in 341 Euroleague games this century. In the final, however, Real Madrid had no trouble scoring as it led Olympiakos 27-10 after one quarter. Being behind by 17 points, however, is just about where Olympiakos fans wanted their team to be. By the time the Reds cut the difference to 4 points by half-time, another fact spoke in their favour. Their leader, Vasilis Panoulis, had not scored yet. And that was not going to last long.
I had a really bad first half. My teammates were there to keep the team close to Real. And after it was my turn to help them to take the trophy.
Spanoulis exploded for 3 three-pointers in a row right after half-time. And soon Hines and Kostas Papanikolaou made a chase-down block that was later chosen the Player of the Year. The comeback kits were back. And before they would be done, they would score 69 second-half points and finish with a 188 victory, the second highest scoring total this century in a championship game.
It was only a kind of perfect, you know, storybook ending for us to be down 17, to come back and to win the game, and not only win the game, but put on such a great offensive performance against, you know, what was traditionally a high-powered scoring team.
Spanoulis would become the first 3-time Euroleague winner to be voted Final Four MVP each time he lifted the trophy.
The character that we created the previous year carry us also in the next year. You know, group of guys that know to win, unselfish, great chemistry roles, and all these things make difficult for the opponents to win us a lot of times, because we never give up. We always be there even if we don't have so good game like this game, down 17. A group of guys that everybody can help, everybody can be important for the team, and that make this team great.
Olympiakos, who no one expected to win the first title in 2012, had become just the third repeat champion in Final Four history.
team was definitely special. I mean, I think it was definitely a one of a kind team. I guess the saying says that, you know, lightning only strikes in the bottle once. And I think that team was just a special team. I think just the chemistry we had on and off the court is basically what made us such a special team. We believe in each other. We believe 100% no matter what the score was, no matter what, you know, what the results was on the floor, we believe in each other. And we also had a fighting spirit. No matter what, no matter what the odds were, we were going to fight and we were going to stay determined and stay believing in each other. And I think that's what made that team, that those 2 years, different from any other team I ever played with.
Drama continued in round three of the top 16. Here are the highlights from all over Europe. In Group E, Fenerbahce won a battle of unbeaten teams against Lokomotiv in the game of the week. Crvena Zvezda got off the mark at Panathinaikos. Unikaha easily overcame Cedevita, and Efes won a local derby against Darul Shafaka. In a big battle between Group E's two unbeaten teams for the game of the week, Lokomotiv Kuban led most of the way against Fenerbahce as Victor Klaver scored 21 points, but the host prevailed after mounting a spectacular fourth quarter comeback behind Bogdan Bogdanovic and Luigi Datome, scoring 34 points in the final 10 minutes. In Athens, James Gist led Panathinaikos, but the home team never had enough to compete with Crvena Zvezda, which marched to its first top 16 victory behind a strong all-round performance from playmaker Stefan Jovic, who came close to a triple-double. At home to Cedevita, Unikaha Malaga started strong and quickly established a double-digit lead. Despite 24 points from Cedevita's Luka Babic, the Spanish team never let up and eventually won by 23, as the consistent Mindaugas Kuzminskas top-scored for his team with 17 points. And Group E concluded with a local derby in Istanbul, where Darul Shafaka was paced by 20 points from Scotty Wilbekin. But Efes's backcourt duo of Thomas Hertel and Jason Granger combined for 18 assists while committing just one turnover. And Derek Brown added 13 points plus 8 rebounds as the home team cruised to a comfortable victory. Fenerbahce stands alone at the head of Group E with Unikaha, Efes and Lokomotiv a game behind. Darul Shafaka is the group's only winless team. In Group F, Olympiakos lost its perfect record against Bamberg. CSKA Moscow dominated Barcelona. Real Madrid outscored Žalgiris and Himki powered past the challenge of Laboral. In Group F, a clash of heavyweights saw Barcelona compete well in a high-scoring opening quarter with CSKA Moscow. But the injury-hit home team gradually pulled away, with Corey Higgins scoring 20 points and Andrei Voroncevic adding 16 points plus 9 rebounds as CSKA eased to a convincing victory. Olympiakos Piraeus took an unbeaten record into its home meeting with Brose Baskets Bamberg, but the German side raced to a double-digit lead behind a big night from Darius Miller, who scored 23 points. Olympiakos tried to fight back, but Nicolò Melli grabbed 13 rebounds as Bamberg recorded its first ever top 16 road win. The legendary Sarunas Jasikevičius coached his first Euroleague game with Žalgiris Kaunas, but Real Madrid's big man duo took charge as Gustavo Ayón claimed 15 rebounds and weekly MVP Felipe Reyes scored a career-high 24 points to give the reigning champions a hard-fought victory. And in Moscow, Laboral Kucha battled hard and stayed close in the first half, but Himki raced away in the second period as James Augustine scored 22 points and claimed 8 rebounds, while Alexei Shved registered 24 points and Tyrese Rice delivered 13 assists to lead the Russian team to victory. Olympiakos' defeat means that no less than 5 teams are tied for first place in an extraordinarily tight group, which has Žalgiris as the only team still looking for its first top 16 win. Yanis Strelnieks of Broza Baskets Bamberg had already a model when he was growing up in Latvia. His older brother Arturs, who is also a professional basketball player. The brothers played together at Ventspils for two seasons and remain very strong supporters of each other's careers.
We are five members. I have two older brothers, but just me and my older brother playing basketball, and he was actually the first who started. I was like 7 years old, and my brother during the summer, he was playing the street ball, and I was too young and I couldn't participate in this, so I was traveling with him and just watching him playing, so that was my earliest. My bigger brother, okay, he was older than me and he was already playing, and just one day he asked me if I wouldn't try, because so far I did like just singing. I was a little kid and dancing something, so he asked me if I want to try, so I did, and I liked it and I still like it. It was actually really cool time to play together, because brother in the same team, sometimes it can be tough, but we always support each other and we still support. We are watching each other's games, so that was cool, and I hope so one day we will play together again. My mom and my dad, they didn't play basketball when they were kids or whatever, but yes, with him we can talk about the basketball. With my parents we can talk about just there was a good game or bad game, nothing like little details, but we never, after the bad games we are talking with my brother, but we never say you could do this, that, do that and something like that. We just try to support and say just keep your head up and try next time.
Diving out of bounds or getting floor burns were countable statistics, Carlos Suarez of Unicaja Malaga might lead the Euroleague in both. Suarez has dedicated most of his 20 minutes per game, over 125 Euroleague appearances this decade, to hustle plays. And it's no coincidence that his teams for the last five seasons have always ranked among the top five in rebounding.
Yo creo que los grandes equipos tienen muy en cuenta el rebote, ¿no? Es primordial, ¿no? Una de las cosas más importantes que hay. Y bueno, al estar en el Real Madrid y en Unicaja, pues son grandes equipos y va todo en acorde a lo que al rebote, ¿no?
Suárez doesn't hesitate to reveal the secret to getting those rebounds.
Bueno, yo creo que el rebote es deseo. El máximo reboteador de la historia de la Euroliga no es el más alto, como es Felipe Reyes, que es el mejor reboteador que yo con el que he jugado. Y bueno, lo que ves es que va a por todas en cada rebote, y eso es lo principal que tiene que tener un reboteador.
On top of that, Suarez is a firm believer that the main ingredient to rebounding excellence or any other hustle skill is attitude. Something he shows on courts all over Europe.
Yo creo que también eso va un poco en el carácter de cada uno, ¿no? Soy un poco, digamos, caliente en la cancha, bastante diferente de lo fuera.
Suarez first came by his hunger at home. His father, a coach, planted the seed of basketball devotion in him.
La afición del baloncesto pues me llevó a jugar al baloncesto, jugaba al fútbol, pero bueno, en los ratos libres también practicaba con él al baloncesto. Y bueno, yo creo que le debo muchas cosas de las que aprendí cuando era jovencito, se lo debo a él.
Another reason for his intensity is that after scoring 8 points per game at age 18 in his rookie Euroleague season for Estudiantes, Suarez had to wait 5 more to get back to the competition. While waiting, he was studying, however.
Te fijas siempre en jugadores que lo dan todo en la cancha. Al estar en Estudiantes siempre te fijabas en los jugadores que estaban en el primer equipo, y a mí me tocó con Carlos Jiménez, en su momento también Felipe Reyes.
His return to the Euroleague coincided with Real Madrid returning to the Final Four for the first time this century, in two of the three seasons that Suarez was a full-time starter. But also coming off the bench, as he does with Unicaja, Suarez is the chief volunteer to do the dirty work.
Bueno, juegas al final, siempre suena raro, ¿no? Pero siempre digo que me gusta más jugar en el banquillo, ver siempre cómo se desarrolla el partido. Pero bueno, esto no es decir que quiero jugar siempre en el banquillo, ¿no? Cómo va el partido, el quinteto que quiere el entrenador, y siempre tienes que salir al 100%, porque si no estás concentrado, aunque no estés en la cancha, en el campo, pues cuando sales se te nota bastante.
That's another of the lessons that Suarez learned along the way and that matched the golden rule he learned at home.
Al final el baloncesto no solo es talento, ¿no? Sino también tienes que tener ganas a la hora de jugar.
Proving that experience only enhances performance, veteran superstar Felipe Reyes of Real Madrid helped the defending champs take a hard-fought victory on Friday, while earning himself the weekly MVP honour for Top 16 Round 3. In his 243rd Euroleague game, Reyes posted his best scoring night ever in the competition to lead Madrid to a 92-86 home win over Žalgiris Kaunas and its new coach, Sarunas Jasikevičius. Reyes poured in 24 points while taking 6 rebounds to go with 3 assists, a steal and 8 fouls drawn for a performance index rating of 32, the best among all EuroLeague players this week. What's more, he did all that damage in just 20 minutes on the floor, showing why he is ranked 5th in per-minute production in this, his 12th EuroLeague season. Reyes shot 6-4-10 on two-pointers and 6-for-6 from the foul line on his big night, which included 2 3-pointers in as many tries.
Number 5, Istanbul, Turkey, Metin Turin for Darüşşafaka, but Çeri Osman leaps through the sky. He's not finished yet, the ball stays alive, and it's Çeri Osman again going to score the layup, all started by a sensational block from Çeri Osman. Number 4, Athens, Greece. Miroslav Raduljica gives Panathinaikos fans something to cheer. A huge reverse slam from Miroslav Raduljica. Number 3, Istanbul, Turkey. Lokomotiv Kuban light it up. Malcolm Delaney to Anthony Randolph. A spectacular alley-oop slam. Beautiful execution from Lokomotiv Kuban Krasnodar. Malcolm Delaney to Anthony Randall. Number 2, Istanbul, Turkey. Jason Granger with the pass. Derek Brown comes through to finish with a huge dunk. Started with a great pass from Jason Granger, and there's Derek Brown. Number 1, Moscow, Russia. Last seconds of the first half. Milos Teodosic going to try a long-range triple. No, he's not. It's a pass, and Ivan Lazarev goes up for a buzzer-beating alley-oop. You don't see many of those to end the half. Great pass, and a EuroLeague rookie, Ivan Lazarev, with the number 1 play of the week.
Game of the week featuring the world's most famous sporting rivalry and another local derby being played for the very first time in the EuroLeague. Highlight Top 16 Round 4 on Thursday and Friday. In Group E, Istanbul bragging rights will be up for grabs as Darüşşafaka Dolls and Fenerbahçe go head-to-head for their maiden meeting on the European stage, as home team star Emir Prezic looks to get one over Bogdan Bogdanovic and the rest of his former teammates. In the same group, two teams with playoff aspirations meet for the third time this season, with Lokomotiv Kuban Krasnodar and sharpshooting EuroLeague rookie Ryan Berkov hoping to further extend their winning run against Panathinaikos Athens and legend Dimitris Diamantidis. Also in Group E, Cedevita Zagreb welcomes Anadolu Efes, while Unicaja Malaga goes on the road to face Crvena Zvezda. In Group F, the latest edition of the great rivalry between Real Madrid and Barcelona will take the Game of the Week stage at Barclaycard Center in the Spanish capital. former Euroleague MVP Sergio Rodriguez will look to win the backcourt battle for the reigning champions against the competition's all-time leading scorer, Juan Carlos Navarro. Another crunch clash will see Laboral Kucha Vitoria and inspirational veteran Ioannis Borousis face CSKA Moscow and the ever-steady Andrei Vorontsovic for the 13th time in just over 6 years, with the Russian team having won all but two of those previous encounters. Elsewhere in Group F, Himki Moscow are at home to Broza Basket, while Sarunas Jasikevicius has a home coaching debut for Žalgiris Kaunas against Olympiakos. We'll see you next week for more EuroLeague action.